Good morning, everyone. Welcome on this first day of the week, not the last, but the first. As you might have noticed, I'm not Val, who was supposed to be leaving today. She's come down with a nasty cold, and unfortunately I've had to step in. So, as is usually the case when you're trying to interpret somebody else's wishes, I hope I get it right, but bear with me. I'm also having to do double duties because I have to be over there when the band plays, so just bear with me as I scoot around the stage from time to time. Welcome to all of those of you in church. It's very good to see you here. Welcome to all those of you who are online, and welcome to those of you who are indeed catching up on Facebook. We will be doing the notices at the end, so you have to bear with us until the end to hear the notices. They were on the screen earlier on as well. Since we've had all these problems and changes of things, perhaps we need to just pause for a moment and collect our thoughts and remember where we are, that we are in the house of God, we are here to worship. So, no doubt we've all come here with all sorts of different problems and things we've had to do in our lives. So just for a short period, let's all be quiet and come before God humbly. So, today we are continuing with our sermon series on the habits or characteristics of a healthy church. And this Sunday it is gratefulness. There are many things we need to be grateful to God for. And sometimes that may be hard for us to say, but nonetheless it is true. And there are things also, most particularly, we need to be grateful for his great gift to us of Jesus Christ, his Son. So today we come to celebrate harvest. Thank you to those who produced all the floral decorations you saw on the way in. Lovely to see those again. We come today to celebrate harvest, to be grateful to God for his gifts to us, but also to remember those who are not so fortunate as us. As you can see down here, we're going to be taking up two offerings, as it were, as harvest. One is the donation of packet goods and so forth for Food Bank, and thank you to everybody who's turned up for that one. As a volunteer at the Westbury Food Centre, I can testify to the great need that there is still, unfortunately, for these things. They shouldn't really exist, but unfortunately they do, to provide those in desperate need with emergency food supplies. And later on, Ralph and Jane Hanger will be coming to bring us details of Operation Agri, which is dedicated to providing those who don't have the opportunities we have to be self-sustaining, to grow their own crops. And we invite financial donations towards the work of Operation Agri, which is why there are little envelopes you'll see in the pews, and also there will be Ralph and Jane will be at the back over there at the end of the service, and would be very pleased to accept your donations, however you want to give them. So the next item is the call to worship, and Ian, sorry, could we have we need the slides up for the psalm. I think it's called September the 24th slides, it's the PowerPoint. This is one of the, there we go, lovely. So, what we're going to do is read this psalm together. I will read the first line, but I can actually read it from all the way back here. And if you will respond with, "His love endures forever." Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the God of gods. His love endures forever. Give thanks to the Lord of lords. Next slide, please. To him alone who does great wonders. Who by his understanding made the heavens. Who spread out the earth upon the waters. Who made the great lights. The sun to govern the day. The moon and stars to govern the night. His love endures forever. Thank you. So let's pray. Father, we praise you for Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, and for the harvest of good things with which he has filled our days, for the coming of the Holy Spirit, and for the harvest of love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control that are signs of his presence within. Lord, we have come to praise you for the harvest of life and love and the joy of knowing Christ as Saviour and Lord. May our lives continue to bring you a harvest of praise. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen. So at this point, I'm going to put my other hat on, and I'm going to move over here. So the two songs that we're going to sing have been chosen to fit in with our theme of gratefulness. And later on, we're going to have two songs written especially for Operation Agri. The words will be unfamiliar to you, but I guarantee you will know the tunes. So don't worry about those, they'll be up later. So the first one is Give Thanks with a Grateful Heart. I will leave opportunity at the end of each song for people to bring words of praise as they feel led, in whatever language you feel, in whatever form you want to bring it. Give thanks with a grateful heart. Give thanks to the God for his greatest gift of all, his Son, Jesus Christ.
Thank you.
Our Father, once we were weak, but now we can say we are strong. Once we were poor, but now we can say that we are rich beyond anything we could imagine, because you have given us Jesus, your Son. Amen. Our second song is My Heart is Filled with Thankfulness. Give thanks to Jesus for saving us. He was the one who bore the pain that should have been ours. He's the one who has given us life again. My heart is filled with thankfulness.
My heart is filled with thankfulness for Him who loved us, who found the depths of my disgrace and gave me life again, who crushed my curse of sinfulness and clothed me with His life. Sustained all our righteousness with power upon my heart. My heart is filled with thankfulness to Him who walks beside, who floods my weaknesses with strength and causes fears to fly, whose every promise is enough for every step I take, sustaining me with arms of love and crowning me with grace. My heart is filled with thankfulness to Him who reigns above, whose wisdom is my perfect peace, whose every thought is love. For every day I have on earth is given by the King. So I will give my life, my all, to love and follow Him. For every day I have on earth is given by the King. So I will give my life, my all, to love and follow Him.
Please be seated. So now hopefully we shall have prayers for others from Mary. Sorry, I said that only because I wasn't sure whether it was going to be electronic or physically here. Good to see you.
Shall we now bring our prayers of confession and intercession to the Lord? Let us pray. O Lord, our Father, we thank you for your love for us, shown in Jesus' death and his resurrection, which brings us new life. We acknowledge that he alone is our Saviour, the way, the truth, and the life. As we come to you today in thanksgiving for your blessings to us, for your provision of your beautiful world and provision of our daily needs, we confess that we have failed to love you with all our hearts, failed to love our neighbours as ourselves, and have failed to be good stewards of your creation. Creator God, forgive our moments of ingratitude, the spiritual blindness that prevents us from appreciating the wonder that is this world, the endless cycle of nature, of life and death and rebirth. Forgive us for taking without giving, reaping without sowing. Forgive us, Lord, where we have failed to be thankful for all of your blessings. Forgive us, Lord, where we have put our hope in our wealth rather than in you. Forgive us, Lord, where we haven't shared what you have given us with others. Help us to become grateful and generous people as we put our hope in you. As we confess these sins, we give thanks that, as we read in 1 John chapter 1, verse 9, you are faithful and just, and you will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We thank you this morning for all those who seek to alleviate food poverty and many other kinds of deficiencies in your world, in education, healthcare, and necessities of everyday life. In particular, we pray today for the work of Operation Agri and their work in Tanzania, where farmers receive training in effective ways to grow more crops and breed livestock. As they teach others in their community to improve their lives, we pray that these communities will flourish and will come to know you. We pray also for Baptist World Mission's creation stewardship work, which seeks to assist in restoration of your creation. Bless also all the workers and volunteers in this country who seek to alleviate food poverty. Give politicians and all those with influence the will and the means to reduce this suffering and indignity. We pray for all government leaders, both those in this country and throughout the world, that they will know your wisdom and your guidance. As we lament the ongoing conflict in Ukraine and Sudan and in Karabakh and in the Middle East, we pray for your guidance in very complex political movements and negotiations. We earnestly pray for peace in all these places and your comfort for all who suffer. We pray also for those suffering in Morocco and Libya, for strength and wisdom for those helping, and that aid and relief may reach these countries quickly. As we remember the Pope's visit to Marseille and his words of concern for migrants, we ask that you will guide and give compassion to those who implement migration policies and rules here within Europe and throughout the world. In Australia, in the last few weeks before the referendum on changing the constitution to give a voice to Parliament for First Nations people, we ask that the debates will be fair and helpful. May they aid the process of justice and reconciliation. Bless, we pray, those families and individual people known to us here who are in need of your care and comfort. We pray that those who are sick or facing challenges in their lives may know your love and care. Give them strength and your healing of body and mind. We ask for your blessing on those who have experienced losses in recent times, that you will keep them safe in your love. We remember particularly Kay and her family as they farewell Kay's beloved husband tomorrow. In a moment of silence, we pray for those within this congregation and others near to us who need your restoring and loving touch, and we ask for your peace and comfort for them. We pray for your church worldwide, for your people everywhere who witness to you, especially those who face practical and spiritual challenges, and those who are persecuted for their faith. May they be upheld at all times by the good news of your love. We beseech you to guide and strengthen this congregation, and especially the deacons in this fellowship with their many responsibilities, and all who serve here. And we pray earnestly for the search committee as they seek a new minister, and for those ministers who may consider a call to this congregation. All these things we ask in the precious name of Jesus Christ, as we pray together the prayer which he taught us, using the traditional version. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
And now Jane Hanger is going to come and give us an introduction to Operation Agri and introduce us to the video. Thank you, Jane.
Hi, everyone. I expect some of you will already know quite a bit about Operation Agri, but in case you don't, it started over 60 years ago when BMS asked the Baptist Men's Movement, I expect quite a lot of you will know something about Operation Agri, but to those who don't, it started over 60 years ago when BMS asked the Baptist Men's Movement if they could help by sending out agricultural resources to missionaries who were requesting them. Today, Operation Agri is run mostly by volunteers, which means that any money given, or most of the money given, actually goes out to overseas. I'm one of the trustees, and it's quite a commitment of time, but it's very worthwhile. Presently, Operation Agri works in 10 countries and supports 14 projects. Many of these try to help people become less dependent on outside resources. So it trains them in making things and growing things and doing things, so they don't have to actually spend money buying from outside, which in the present situation where everything's gone up so, is very, very important. Operation Agri helps with that, with training and ideas, and it also sometimes helps them buy equipment they need to make stuff that they otherwise would have to buy. And the other things that sometimes happen is they make funds available for buying better breeds of animals and also better varieties of crops. And then once they've got these, the farmers will breed them themselves and distribute them amongst themselves. So in a sense, that's also self-supporting. The video we're about to watch is on Tanzania, as we heard in the prayers. It's a project that shows farmers being trained in this way, helping them to become more self-sufficient, helping them to be able to feed their families better, and hopefully to have some spare cash to get their kids educated so that they get out of the poverty trap. All the Operation Agri projects are headed up by a Christian, but they definitely are available to the whole population, whatever their faith. The gospel is spread in the sense that people see the love of Jesus in action, and they see the people who lead the projects being Christians. So people are drawn in, although that is not, let's say, the main end. It's one of the ends. We've got a table at the back. If you'd like to come and see, and any questions you have, yeah, I'll try and answer them. Okay, now we're going to watch the video.
Operation Agri helps families to transform their farms in northern Tanzania. Anna Mary Gideon is weeding her crop of onions, which she grows to sell. She had 2 years training from FPI, the Farming Partnership Initiative, and she then trained others in her locality. Now she's going to her banana plot to get some plantain bananas. Planted in compost, with beans growing in their shade, they grow tall and healthy. But how do you get them down? Hack the stem and give it a shake, and down they come. This is, after all, not a tree, but a giant plant. A banana leaf gives protection as she carries the heavy load home, ready to cook the meal. And she gets a welcome from the children.
Hi, Mum.
First, wash hands. Stand well back to avoid splashes. Then wash the homegrown beans and put them on the fire to cook. Next, peel the bananas. When cooked and prepared like mashed potato, these are a staple of their diet. Meanwhile, Mr. Gideon is chopping a jackfruit, and the children hope for a taste of it. The FPI training helps farmers to have animals for milk and meat, and shows how to build pens and which are good leaves to feed them. A few beans are a tasty treat. Time to feed the pig. These animals are valuable for the manure they produce to fertilize crops, as well as producing plenty of piglets to sell. Anna Mary helps local farmers adopt FPI methods.
In our group, we are 30 farmers, but the active ones are 20. For our farmers group, our main cash crop is onions.
She says their farmers didn't know how to get good crops, but after her FPI training in sustainable farming, they now grow much more to sell and make a profit. They can now afford school uniforms, shoes, books, and other expenses, so that children who'd missed out on school can now get an education.
As my wife says, on our farm, we are very pleased with our onions. We have also done well with rearing goats.
He has been building a new toilet block, thanks to the profits from their farm, a great improvement on the old toilet.
We give thanks to God. We value this help. Thank you.
Fifty kilometers further north, another group of farmers has gathered from six local communities for their next session of training with the FPI team. Today, Boazi is teaching them how to make their own pesticide from local resources. They've gathered leaves of tobacco, neem, and other plants that can kill or repel bugs like aphids and weevils. The plants are each pounded in the traditional African way, taking turns. Then added to a bucket with chili peppers for extra bite. The mix is soaked in water with ash and soap powder added to combat pests and a little paraffin to kill their eggs. This toxic soup is strained through a cloth, then poured into a sprayer together with water. So who volunteers to try this backpack sprayer? Pumping the handle gives an effective spray to banish pests without buying costly commercial pesticides.
As you have seen today, we teach farmers more organic ways to make pesticide because using chemicals can have bad effects on people's health.
The farmers make careful notes of all they are learning. Agnes is introducing the next topic on making liquid fertilizers. The first method uses nitrogen-rich plants like comfrey. This time, the leaves are just chopped, put in a bucket, with ash added for added potassium. Water is added and the mix left to soak. After a couple of weeks, it is strained, diluted, and used to water crops. Really useful and simple. The second type of liquid fertilizer requires a sack and a lovely bucket of manure. Scoop manure into the sack, tie it to a pole, and suspend it in water. After soaking a few days, use it in a watering can, diluted, to give bananas and other crops a real boost.
Mafanikio katika mradi huu, wakulima wameweza kuwa na mapokeo ya kupokea mambo mbalimbali.
The advantage of this project is that farmers learn many things, such as how to care for the soil and to use organic fertilizer, how to make good compost and conservation farming systems.
Thank you.
Through Operation Agri, we've been able to reach hundreds of farmers. On behalf of my team workers in FPI, I say thank you to Operation Agri, but also all supporters who support Operation Agri. Thank you very much.
They rejoice and thank God for all they have learnt. Please give generously to help Operation Agri transform the lives of farmers like these, showing Christian love in action.
So we're now going to sing a song especially composed by Operation Agri. During this song, if the children would like to go through this door here, Joan, who's sitting over there, waving furiously, and Chris, who is, where are you, Chris? Chris is waving at the back there. I've arranged a little activity for you up in our club room. So if you'd like to go with them during the singing of this song, that would be great. Praise God, whose grace has guided. As I said, you won't know the words, but you'll definitely know the tune when we sing it. So please stand for Praise God, whose grace has guided.
Praise God, As you can see, I'm not Jean. She's currently lost her voice, so perhaps we can pray for healing for her. Our readings today, there are two of them. The first is a short reading from 2 Kings, chapter 4, verses 42 to 44. And it can be found on page 316 in the Old Testament section of the Church Bibles. 2 Kings 4, 42 to 44. A man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing the man of God some of the new season's bread, 20 barley loaves, and fresh ripe ears of grain. Elisha said, "Give this to the people to eat." His attendant protested, "I cannot set this before 100 people." Still, he insisted, "Give it to the people to eat. For this is the word of the Lord. They will eat, and there will be some left over." So he set it before them, and they ate and had some left over, as the Lord had said. Our second reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verses 6 to 13. And that can be found on page 165 in the New Testament section of the Church Bibles. 2 Corinthians 9, 6 to 13. Remember, sow sparingly and you will reap sparingly. Sow bountifully and you will reap bountifully. Each person should give as he has decided for himself. There should be no reluctance, no sense of compulsion. God loves a cheerful giver. And it is in God's power to provide you with all good gifts in abundance, so that with every need always met to the full, you may have something to spare for every good cause. As Scripture says, he lavishes his gifts on the needy. His benevolence lasts forever. Now he who provides seed for the sowing and bread for food will provide the seed for you to sow. He will multiply it and swell the harvest of your benevolence. And you will always be rich enough to be generous. Through our action, such generosity will issue in thanksgiving to God. For as a piece of willing service, this is not only a contribution to the needs of God's people. More than that, it overflows in a flood of thanksgiving to God. For with the proof which this aid affords, those who receive it will give honour to God when they see how humbly you obey him and how faithfully you confess the gospel of Christ. And they will thank him for your liberal contribution to their need and to the general good. May the Lord add his blessing to this reading from his word. Amen.
Now, if Ralph will come and bring us some message, can I just pray with you before
you
start?
Yeah,
okay. I'm trying to avoid the feedback. Father, I ask that you will bless Ralph as he leads us. You will open our ears to hear what you have to say to us through him. You will give us the will to apply what we hear to our lives and carry it out in practice. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. We'll try to avoid that, shall we? I'll move away from the mic a bit. Well, I gather that you are in the middle of a series, The Habits of a Healthy Church. Let's just see what we can get. Is it going to come up on us? We got it? It's coming, hopefully. The Habits of a Healthy Church. Well, what habits can we associate with harvest? Clearly, the habit of harvest, associated with harvest, is one of thankfulness. Thankfulness to God for all that he has given to us. We're going to look at this habit a little bit, both the Old Testament and the New Testament, and see how it is important to us in our daily lives. Looking at the video that we've just seen, I think this isn't going to work. Can you move it on for me, please? Looking at the video that we've just seen, we realise that life in Tanzania is a little bit nearer to the life of the Old Testament than it is to life in Leamington. No supermarkets, no packed foods, very much basic down to living off the earth where you live. As the Israelites in the wilderness were approaching the promised land where God promised them bounty and all sorts of things, he gave them a lot of rules and laws to help them, to guide them, because they'd never been there before, they didn't know how to live under those circumstances, and God gave them some very important rules on how to live in this new circumstance. And one of those was what comes before harvest. You see, harvest is at the end when everything is coming in and we say, thank God for all that has happened. But harvest has three sections. I don't know if you realize that. Harvest has the beginning, it has the work, and then it has the bringing in of the goods. And right at the beginning, as the first crops were being produced, God gave instructions to his people, we can move on please, to bring the first fruits. The very first fruits of the crop were to be given to him. Now these first fruits were important. They didn't know what the harvest was going to be like, so they couldn't tell how much they could afford to give. They were told to bring the first fruits. Can we move on? And we'll see some of the concepts of what the first fruits meant, because it was a command from God. It wasn't an option. God said, when you come in, bring the first fruits to my house. Bring them to me. It was God's command. And it was a command to say thank you. Thank you that the crops have produced. And that's something which we need to cultivate, this idea of thankfulness. You see, when we say thank you, we acknowledge God's provision. It's God who has provided. When we come to the harvest, God has provided the harvest. We're speaking with somebody at the beginning of the service, talking about the weather. We can never guarantee the weather, can we? We know that so well. We were remembering back to the storm of, you know, Michael Fisher's time and so on. We know that we can't rely on the weather, but God has it in his hands. And farmers know very well the importance of bringing in the harvest and how weather dependent it is. We acknowledge God is in control. We don't do that so well nowadays, do we? We don't always depend on God and say, thank you, Lord, for my salary. I wonder how many of us thank God for our salary every month it comes in. I wonder how many of us acknowledge it comes from God. And one of the other things that God told the Israelites to say thank you for was the skills that they were given. The skills that God had given them to work the land and to bring in the harvest. And there's a very clear instructions in Deuteronomy when they came into the promised land that they should never forget that what they have got hasn't come from Amazon. It hasn't come from Google. It hasn't come from any of our modern things. It has come from him. He allows us to have what we have. Are we really grateful to God for that? And so first fruits was a sacrificial giving because they didn't know what was coming, whether it was going to be a good crop or a bad crop. They could guess, but God said, bring me the first things. Bring those to me first. And that is what was happening in the story that we heard read to us earlier on. Thank you. Can we have the next slide? Which tells us the story that a man came from Baal Shalisha, bringing the man of God 20 loaves of barley, bread baked from the first ripe grain, along with some heads of new grain. This is what was to come from the first crop that they had. This unnamed man brought his offering of grain to Elisha, the man of God, as the first fruits of his crop. When Elisha received the crop, the gift, he was very happy. And so were the men around him. He had a kind of a Bible school going, a company of prophets, they were called. And they were very happy because at that time there was a famine in the land. They were just getting in their crops, but there's a famine. We hear in the stories, the verses just before that, that these prophets, these sons of the prophets, have been out in the field foraging for food, for a stew. So they were very happy to be getting bread and so on. Elisha said, give this bread to the men. Thank you. Can we move on? give this bread to the men. And his servant said, how can I give this to 100 people? He said 20 loaves of bread, but to be honest, 20 loaves of bread wasn't like 20 loaves from the supermarket. They were more like the buns and the scones that we would be getting. It wasn't enough for 100 people? How can I give that to 100 people? Elisha had not kept it for himself, he'd given it to the men. And Elisha said, you just give it to them. You do your bit, you give it to them, and you'll see what will happen. Give it to the people to eat. This is what the Lord says they will have. They will eat and have some left over. And next slide, please. They ate and they had some left, according to the word of the Lord. Does that remind you of any stories from the New Testament? Remember the feeding of the 5,000, the feeding of the 4,000? We know those stories. So did you realize there was an Old Testament equivalent of it? Interesting, isn't it? What was the common factor? The common factor was that they had brought food to God, and God had multiplied it to the needs of the people there. Interesting, isn't it? Doesn't have to be a lot. It's bringing it to God, and God uses it. You might say in your mind, well, great, but what little I can bring, what can that do? Can we see the next slide, please? Well, in Tanzania, farmers are trained to help themselves by Tanzanian trainers who've been trained by other Tanzanians or some by expatriates. They're supported by Operation Agri, and Operation Agri is supported by donors like you and me. Okay, so that's where we fit in. We're at the bottom. But you might say, as I was saying, if we look at the next slide, you might say, well, what little I may be able to give, what effect does that have on the big need there is? Yeah, I mean, Tanzania, do you know how big Tanzania is? It's about 8 times the United Kingdom. Massive country. It's on the shores of Lake Victoria, in case any of you remember. And Lake Victoria is the size of Ireland. Interesting, isn't it? Okay, can we move on? Because I want to remind you of some Tanzanian sayings. Little by little, fills a bucket. Drops of rain fall softly, but can flood the river and overflow its banks, little by little, just a bit at a time. And if you're worried about the impact of a tiny thing, a tiny bit that I can give, just think about the mosquito. If you think you're too small to make a difference, try spending a night with a mosquito. The buzz of the mosquito all night, the fret of the biting, it keeps you awake, just a tiny little mosquito. Little things can have a big impact. And as you may be thinking to yourself, I can't do a lot for giving to help people. Whatever you give, if you give it to God sacrificially, then he will use it well. Let's see the next slide. Gifts given to God in obedience have more effect than their face value, because it's God who takes them and uses them. There is that second passage that we read today, which really needs a full exposition. It's a great passage, and I'm just going to jump into it and pick out a few bits, but I do recommend that you go back to it and study it as a passage itself. It's from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And in this, Paul writes about the importance of generosity. And gratitude and generosity, they both start with G, don't they? But you know, they're very closely linked up when you come to think about it. Let's have a look at some of these. Can we move on to the next slide, please? have a look at this passage a little bit. Oh, this is what Jesus said. Sorry, I'm jumping ahead of myself. Jesus said, you can't outgive him. You can't outgive God. Did you know that? You can't give God more than he'll give to you. This is what Jesus said. Given, it will be given to you, a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, running over, poured into your lap. With the measure you use, it will be measured to you. This is Jesus. So we've got the Old Testament example of Elisha. We've got Jesus, and then we can move on to Paul in 2 Corinthians chapter 9. And see some of the things that he says. He says, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. Now, there you go. Don't feel under any pressure to give to Operation Agri, unless God puts it on your heart. And if he puts it on your heart, then do what he says. Give cheerfully, because you want to give to serve and to say thank you. To say thank you for what you have been given. See, God is able to bless you abundantly, so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you'll abound in every good work. So if you have that attitude of giving, if you have that attitude of serving through giving, you're not going to lose out, because God knows and he will provide you with what you can give. If God wants you to give, he'll give you what to give with. You see what I mean? Let's move on. Now, these words were written by Paul when he had received a gift from other Christians elsewhere. He'd received that gift, and he was responding to that gift through this letter, talking about generosity. And so he says, this service, that means this gift which you have given to me, that you perform, is not only supplying the needs of the Lord's people, but is also overflowing in many expressions of thanks to God. Did you notice that in the video? Did you notice Pastor Gideon? Did you notice other people there? They thanked God for the gifts which people here have given. So as we give gifts to Operation Agri and to other organizations, I'm not limiting to Operation Agri, there's so many things we need to give to. But as we give our gifts, we are causing other people to thank God. It's a positive, isn't it? It's not just meeting their needs, it's causing them to thank God. And then in verse 14, in their prayers for you, their hearts will go out to you because of the surpassing grace God has given you. Isn't that interesting? And I have seen this happen. I have seen it happen. People who receive gifts through people like Operation Agri and other places, they first of all thank God, and then they pray for those people who've made it necessary, made it possible. People in Tanzania praying for you. Now that can't be bad, can it? I mean, do you want people to pray for you? You want people to pray for you. Give them cause to pray for you. Support them, help them. Do what you can to help them, and then they will join in praying for you as individuals and as a church. You see, your healthy habits, your habits of a healthy church, it is the church as a whole, but it's only because individuals are living that way, isn't it? You as individuals need to learn to live God's way, and then the church lives God's way as you do it together. Thankfulness, thanking God for what he's given to us. And unless you've been to places like Tanzania and other places where they're less privileged, you can't fully understand it. We've lived there for many years. We lived in East Africa. And we know what it's like to see people brought out of poverty, to see people developing for themselves, because people in this country have given to God. You notice that? The first fruits are given to God. The tithe is given to God. This enables God's people to do the work that he has set them to do. And as they do that work, the recipients learn to thank God. They learn to thank you, and they learn to pray for you. Now, I think there's a habit to pick up, isn't it? Generosity out of gratitude. So you've got two G's, two habits. Generosity out of gratitude. And these people, we know that Heaven Light, by the way, who ended that, we know him personally. And he was a friend of ours. And I actually introduced him to Operation Agri. So that's a personal link. But that's the way in which we can be part of the body of Christ. That's the way in which we can support people in other places. And just remember that mosquito. It doesn't have to be a lot. It only needs one bite. And it's had its effect. As you give, God magnifies the gift that you've given. Let's just summarize it, shall we? Can we go through? We thank God by giving to others. The size of our gift does not limit the good God can bring from it. We cannot outgive God. He always blesses our sacrificial giving. And again, the next. We should always give what God prompts us to give. Not what anybody else tells you, what God puts on your heart, and then you can give cheerfully and joyfully. Our giving causes other people to thank God, and our giving causes other people to pray for us. So there's the habit. Thank you. Final. A healthy church thanks God by cheerfully giving to others. We're going to sing another song, which is one which you, again, don't know the words of, but you know the tune exceptionally well. And it brings with it a level of commitment to our service to God. Thank you. Today, calling
God of harvest, God of sharing, God who meets us in our need. Fill us with the love of caring, save us from our hidden greed. Jesus gave away his glory. Help your people do the same. Help your people live his story, sowing riches in his name. Amen. We finish by saying the grace to each other. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Please take a seat.